During World War II, shipyards in the Bay Area employ over 200,000 workers. Building the ocean-going vessels needed to beat the Axis powers.
At any time the tide dictated, day or night, rain or shine, ships quietly slipped into San Francisco Bay, faster and faster.
To ensure uninterrupted production, the government persuades companies to stop resisting labor organizing. In return, unions agree to a no-strike pledge. This is a new way of doing things for the labor movement. Rank-and-file worker militancy during the Great Depression of the 1930s had created unions that relied on democratic participation and direct action work stoppages to settle disputes with their bosses. Through these methods, unions grew into effective advocates for working people's interests, but not without sacrifice. The 1934 San Francisco General Strike began after longshoreman Howard Sperry and cook Nick Bourdois were killed by police attempting to break a coastwide maritime workers' strike. Such tragedies were all too common for working people during their struggle to establish unionism as a legitimate part of American life. During the war, however, grievance procedures, not strikes, settle workplace disputes. Direct rank-and-file involvement and mass actions are replaced by a more bureaucratic union representation system. Meanwhile, the composition of the Bay Area workforce, the union rank-and-file, is transformed by the war.
From each state in the Union and almost every hamlet in the nation, these 20th century pioneers converged on San Francisco Bay.
African Americans come up from the South to work in the shipyards.
Now tell me, brother pilgrim, tell me where I'm bound. You're bound for dear old Canaan to that enchanted ground.
White farming families emigrate from Oklahoma, Arkansas, and the Southwest.
Out of the dust bowl and westward we rolled, and your deserts are hot and your mountains are cold.
Women exchange housework for a good union paycheck in the war industries.
They are taking to welding as though the welding rod were a needle and the metal a length of cloth to be sewn. After a short apprenticeship, a woman can operate this drill press as easily as a juice extractor in her own kitchen.
Not all the newcomers know how their brothers and sisters won their rights and paychecks through the hard battles of the pre-war years. Labor leaders have added responsibilities and worries. Teaching new workers about unionism takes time that's hard to find. But with the wartime emergency over, many employers want to bring back the good old days of the anti-union open shop as they did after World War I.
Wages have to be frozen, Joe. The workers are making too much money for their own good. And prices haven't risen very much, have they, Joe?
In response to the boss's anti-labor offensive, working people launched the greatest wave of strikes in United States history. Across the country, millions of workers walk picket lines, shutting down entire industries. Many are World War II veterans, disturbed at their poor treatment after fighting for their country. In Hollywood, thousands of craft workers organized in the left-wing Conference of Studio Unions, led by set painter Herb Sorrell, battled the studio bosses. Strikebreakers are supplied by Roy Brewer's International Association of Theatrical and Stage Employees. Brewer perfects an old tactic soon to grow quite popular once again inside the labor movement, red-baiting his opponent Sorrell. Studio moguls are also able to bring police into the battle on their side. The Conference of Studio Unions loses. Despite his troubles, Sorrell takes the time to send a message of support northward to AFL brothers and sisters involved in another struggle.
In Oakland, California, a general strike tied up the entire area. Bus and train service ceased to exist in a dispute characterized by Dave Beck, Teamster leader in the Far West area, as a lot of foolishness and more like a revolution than an industrial dispute. Meanwhile, the lives of nearly 750,000 people had been affected.
Hold on. Did you understand what you just saw? I didn't. The perspective of the newsreel seems to be that these Oakland workers were doing something senseless. Using the same film footage, perhaps we could imagine another perspective, something like this. Owners of Conn's and Hastings department stores refuse to recognize a union favored by their employees. Hundreds of clerks went out on strike. Police beat up picketers and helped the Retail Merchants Association bring goods across picket lines. Outraged Oakland unionists called a general strike. For 2 days, Oakland stood still until owners and the city agreed to negotiate with workers' representatives. Okay, we've heard two different sets of facts. The newsreel selected some, we selected others. But each version of the story is missing something. Perhaps the striking workers themselves should be heard from.
I was working in the shoe department, and I was making, $28 a week at that time, and, just getting out of the service.
The only problem was that when I found, after talking to other people in specialty stores, such as Peter Brothers and Cushions, they were making $10 or better a week, better than I was. And I went to the union and asked why they didn't organize the store.
These people came on back, and I mean, my brother Americans and also the gals that came back from the war. And when they held out their hand for just a little piece of pie, the answer was no.
One employer whose voice says no the loudest is Joseph Noland, publisher of the Oakland Tribune and longtime spokesman for conservative business interests. His newspaper labels moderate unionists extreme elements and warns of an impending communist takeover of Oakland.
Noland dominated the politics in Oakland, and he had the Tribune, which was his voice. And everyone felt that all the decisions for the city were made at the Tribune Tower, not at City Hall.
Very, very conservative, very anti-union. His paper was something that we got every day to read and then got mad about.
Along with Noland, another major anti-union force in Oakland is the Retail Merchants Association. It demands that the Retail Clerks Union organize all 28 stores in the association before it will recognize the union at Conn's and Hastings.
What precipitated the strike was the firing of one of the people who had joined the union. One of the ladies who had joined and signed up with the union was fired. Originally, we had somewhere in the area of between 70 and 80% of the workers came out. And I would say the same thing applied at Hastings.
The women were fantastic as far as holding up and their sense of humor and being on the picket line. I'd set the schedules up and they'd be there, rain or shine.
Well, it was like any picket line. Everybody walked up and down, carried signs and yelled, "Don't be a scab." It was pretty effective. They were keeping most of the people out. People would come, see what was going on, and then turn away. But some went through.
And tempers would flare. But I think that the tempers that flared were not the pickets, but the people going through the line, knowing in their own heart, very probably, that they were doing the wrong thing.
Despite a mostly peaceful picket line, feelings sometimes run high. Picket Captain Gwendolyn Byfield calls a strikebreaker scab and rat. She is arrested, but charges are dropped. After weeks go by without a settlement, the Retail Merchants Association and their friends in the Noland political machine decide to take a different approach.
I went back over to the picket line. By the time I got back over there, the cops are pushing our people off the street and towing the automobiles away.
They beat us all out of the alleys, pushed us with those damn billy clubs. I was black and blue here for months. The trucks followed right behind them, went on in and unloaded. Then he went back to get more. It wasn't bringing in strike breakers necessarily that started the general strike. I thought about that a lot since that. We'd seen strike breakers. But the thing was using the police force that we were paying taxes for to beat us off our own streets.
By morning, everybody had heard about what had happened. It was in the papers, and unions had heard. Everybody was very upset, and we all just went out on the streets.
Al Brown was the head of the Carmen's local at that time. The streetcars were still running on Broadway. And he came down Broadway in a streetcar. And the police were out there, and they had Broadway blocked off. And he came up to the blockade, and the cop said, "It's all right, you can take your streetcar through." And he said, "Well, what's the deal?" They told him what they were doing, and he said, "Well, no, I've never crossed a picket line in my life, and I'm not about to now." So he climbed out, he took the controls out of the streetcar, climbed out of the streetcar, and that was it. That was the spark that started the whole thing at that particular time, because every streetcar backed up behind him. They couldn't move his streetcar. He told the buses to stop, and they had an emergency meeting, and for 3 days, just about nothing turned in Alameda County.
We didn't call it general strike, we called it a work holiday.
Everybody was having a good time, but the crowd was good. Nothing unruly. I didn't see any liquor, didn't see any, where could you buy it? It was a holiday mood. It was a feeling of comradeship. It was the feeling that, well, we're all together in this thing, you know. And it was a good, warm, healthy feeling. It was more like what this country should be.
Lay that pistol down, babe. Lay that pistol down.
When Sailors Union leader Harry Lundeberg delivers a fiery address to an overflow crowd at Oakland Auditorium, strike leader Bob Ash thinks that if he'd told the assembly to march to City Hall, they'd have taken the place apart.
The biggest fear that we had during the general strike was we didn't want it to get out of hand. We wanted a peaceful demonstration, as peaceful as it could be. And really it was, when you stop and think that there was only the one incident of the typewriter being thrown through the window at Hastings. Outside of that, nothing really happened.
We might ask one more question. How could a union leader, Teamster National Vice President Dave Beck, say the general strike was
a lot of foolishness and more like a revolution than an industrial dispute?
The General Strike Committee, led by Bob Ash, brings the general strike to a hasty end when Beck orders Teamster members who'd been solidly supportive of the strike to go back to work.
Dave Beck, who are you talking about? You're talking about a man that made millions, went to prison and everything else. He never really represented these unions the way it should be represented. The CIO notified us that if it went past Thursday, that they'd shut off lights and power. And I wanted to continue one more day and shut off the lights and power. Then we'd have had the whole ball of wax.
But the AFL leadership was worried that intervention by militant CIO unions representing 30,000 Alameda County workers in utilities and heavy industry would invite a negative public perception, since a number of communists and their sympathizers were prominent in the Northern California CIO Council.
I think the old CIO, Congress of Industrial Organizations, had a little bit of a bad taint to it at that time. J. Edgar Hoover and a few others were witch-hunting them and working on the communist tactics and the rest of it. And we tried to keep them away from the picket line as much as possible so that we wouldn't have that sort of thing happening to us.
Instead, the AFL Strike Committee accepts a verbal commitment from the city manager that Oakland police would no longer assist strike breaking. They end the general strike Thursday morning after 54 hours. The settlement leaves the retail clerk strike unresolved, which irritates many of their supporters, including Elizabeth Mackin. She writes a letter to Kahn's department store. It is against my principles to go through a picket line. I wish you to close out my account until you have a happier relationship with those who work for you. Despite the obvious depth of community support for the clerks, Kahn's and Hastings still refuse to recognize the union. Worse, the day after the general strike ends, police bring scabs through retail clerks' picket lines. Feeling betrayed, labor leaders threaten another general strike.
Wait, Joe! There's a better way.
Recognizing the need for unity against the Nolan forces, the AFL, the CIO, the NAACP, and other progressive community groups formed the Oakland Voters League.
We had put together all the precinct maps and had these lists of people. We divided the precincts up into areas of 10 precincts.
I was given a map of the precincts. I was given a list of names. I didn't know where they came from, and said, go find people to cover the precincts. It was a very interesting experience. This was in West Oakland, an area of mixed black and white.
Building a bridge between the labor movement and minority communities, the Oakland Voters League runs five candidates in the spring 1947 city council election.
It all went off amazingly smoothly and was a wonderful victory when we won 4 out of the 5 candidates.
Although this leaves the Oakland Voters League one seat short of a majority on the 9-member council, labor's victory cracks the anti-union Nolan machine for the first time in decades. Oakland's working people have a political voice and can no longer be ignored. One result is that the week after the election, the Retail Merchants Association recognizes the Retail Clerks Union in all of its stores.
Whoever won before in Oakland? We showed by the general strike, if you hang together, you can take anybody on.
It was a unique experience in my life to be involved in anything with such masses of people. I was really proud of the union members that came out. It convinced me more than ever that the union was the way to go for working people.
When you say, what did it do for people, I think it gave them a greater sense of power.
A sense discovered by people like picket captain Gwendolyn Byfield and streetcar driver Al Brown. Along with 100,000 other ordinary working people, they stepped out of the shadows traditionally assigned to them to make history during their work holiday, the Oakland General Strike of 1946.
Lay that pistol down, babe. Lay that pistol down. Pistol packing, mama. Lay that pistol down.